I know you want to know, and I'm here to tell you, it just ain't that easy. I get this question asked all the time. Which of these two should I buy, the Blackbox or the Digitakt? And it comes from a range of different people, but honestly, these two do cross paths a lot in a lot of areas, but they are two completely different products when it comes to mindset or the way you make music, the way you think about music, the way you approach making music, even down to like your ego and id, which is something I struggle with a lot as well. They excel in certain areas and kind of, you know, aren't the best in certain areas. And I kind of boiled it down to five things that I think are the most fundamental when trying to decide between which of these two you should get. But that doesn't mean that outside of those five things that they are exactly the same, because they are worlds apart. So yeah, first off, the thing I wanted to get into the most, I got my notes here so I can kind of make sure I stay on track, but the track limitations. Hey, stay on track, track limitations. All right, we're on track, let's do this. So on the Digitakt, you have 8 tracks. Oh, and by the way, if you're expecting to hear any audio samples or anything like that, I'll see you next week. This video ain't gonna have any. So you got 8 tracks on the Digitakt and you have 16 tracks on the Blackbox. Immediately, that's a win. I know some people might say, oh, 8 tracks is more than enough. And it is in some cases, but having 16 is amazing. For example, let's say in some of my tracks, I'm around the main parts of my tracks, I would usually only have about 8 parts going at a time. And in some rarer cases, that would also include 8 individual drum sounds. So let's kind of put that to practice, right? Say we have a kick, a clap, accent snare, closed hat, open hat, I don't know, and a percussion. That's 6 tracks. What does that leave me with? 2 tracks to do chord stuff or something, and then a bass line. That's it. Forget throwing the B part of your song in there. Forget adding new sounds, maybe more percussive elements. And I know, on the Digitakt, you can parameter lock a lot of different things so that you can have different samples per step and change up the pitch and all this stuff. But at that point, you are programming a song. And me personally, that's not that fun. I want my tool to, in a way, encourage creativity, which this definitely does instill. But I also want it to not slow me down when it comes to basic things, because like I can go into track and then I can go into chromatic and play a single sample chromatically. But if I want to change that sample, then I got to go and parameter lock all that and then parameter lock all their notes. Where let's apply that same logic to here on the Blackbox. We have those 6 tracks, right? Then I add my chord thing and then, oh, hold on. 6 tracks, chord thing, bass line, boom, 8 tracks. Then I have an entire Digitakt worth of tracks to do whatever the hell I want. 16 tracks on the Blackbox is awesome. It's just such it's the perfect amount of tracks, because then that means I can put on little random one-shots that happen once every 128 bars, or I can throw some loops in there and not worry about taking up a bunch of track space. And another thing about the Blackbox, I use it mainly as a looper and kind of a like a stem playback, sample playback, play some loops and stuff that are in time. And I don't do that so much on the Digitakt because of storage, which is another point I want to mention later on. But right now, what it comes down to how you use these things. I use the Digitakt as a glorified drum machine, or I guess just kind of a drum machine. I don't know why I tacked glorified on there. It's really, really good at that. I use all 8 tracks as mainly just one shots and single hits, because it does not have time stretching and it does not have any kind of play to the tempo, lock it in time type of playback for your samples, and it doesn't do any slicing. The Blackbox does all of that, albeit the time stretching is it's okay. I would definitely say if you're speeding up your tempo from a track, you're good to go. If you're slowing it down, be careful. It can kind of start to fall apart a bit on the Blackbox. And because of that, that's another reason why I worry about suggesting the Blackbox too, because it's really powerful, but there are moments and things in there that make me feel like it could be refined a little bit more, where the Elektron has like years and years of full-blown musical people behind it and updates, and it's a giant company. Blackbox by 1010 Music is ran by the sweetest dude you'll ever meet, Aaron Higgins, and him and his wife kind of just crank these out. I wonder if they have any more help by now. Who knows? But they are incredible people, and they are geniuses for coming up with something like this in this form factor. So this alone is really beautiful, but this one feels a bit more musical. And that brings us on to another point, their performative aspects and what you can do with these live or while you play them or use them as an instrument. The Digitakt, all day long. I think this is one of the most performative, fun pieces of gear to use. And the Blackbox can be there, but there are a lot of times where I'll be like jamming and playing live, doing my thing. And then when I go to like launch a new part, I stand completely still, make sure my little chorizo fingers don't hit two things at once because it's practically just all a touchscreen. And that's something that you cannot build up muscle memory with quickly as much as you can on these hard style, you know, mechanical keys. I love these keys and I know exactly where things are. Tracks here, patterns there, banks there, source, filter, page, amp, blah, 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 blah. I know what to do. I can do it with my eyes closed. Here, you can get used to it, but dead silent. There's a nice click to it though. I guess the silence thing doesn't really matter. But when it comes to kind of like launching things, you have to be a little worried. I will say this screen to me, again, this whole video is my opinion, is way better than the MPC Live. I have not tried the MPC Live 2. I have not tried the Force. I have not tried the One. My experiences with the MPC Live were not good. I think this touchscreen is way better, even down to playing the keys or playing the kick drum, you know, with some velocity like bump, 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 bump. It's actually really fun and really responsive. But again, live, you don't have that much you can do to go to a filter. Like, let's say this whole beat is playing and I want to filter out baby. I have to hit baby, info, info, and then I got control over the filter. And if I want to jump to another sound, I have to hit this little button. And then out of these baby buttons, select the next sound, which if I don't remember what sound I want to add the filter to, I have to hit pads, go here, hit this, and then I have control over the filter. We're here, track, I'm on the filter. Track, I'm on the filter. Track, I'm on the filter. Immediately, really fast. And then on top of that, you got the control all that stuff. And then you can even temporarily save the project where it's at, do a bunch of things, and then reload the pattern. Boom, that is so fun to do live. But outside of performing live with these things, how are they when you are just using them to make a song? This is very, very important. Electron is smart. They know how to get you to buy all of their things because they're all pretty similar, but they'll just turn off a couple features across different products that are like, ah, oh, if I want this, I need to do that. If I want that, I need to do this. So the Digitakt has no song mode whatsoever. I kind of have a hack for creating a pseudo song mode in this video where you kind of use the patterns weird, but there's no song mode at all. On here, you literally have a button dedicated to song, albeit it's a bit weird to use. I still don't fully understand how to use it. It's really confusing. I hope that they'll change it. I've talked to Aaron about it before, as well as in their forums. They kind of talk about it a bit and trying to find a better way to implement it. So that's another big plus, is that they're regularly updating this thing with new features and they keep whipping out a bunch of crazy different ways to use your samples. You got sample, clip, slicer, granular, new recording, new multi-recording, which is really cool. So I definitely appreciate that about the Blackbox. But if you want something to do a full-blown song from start to finish, you can kind of do it on the Digitakt by itself, but you can definitely, for sure, do it on the Blackbox because, again, those 16 tracks. But I need to stress this again. If you're not comfortable with the touchscreen or you think that'll be kind of weird, you're not going to like this. I personally don't like touchscreens at all, but I think this is one of the best touchscreens I have ever used when making music, to a point where I kind of forget that it is a touchscreen. Like, the only time I think this actually slows me down is when I'm just kind of trying to remember where certain things are. But for example, if I go to pads, I select that track, then I go to info, hit info again, and now I have control over these here, which is like ADSR, miscellaneous options, as well as main, which has your filter and all those other things. But then if I want to change, I have to go back to this page, select another track, then select this, then hit that again, then I have control over this. But let's say I'm in ADSR and I go here and I go to my kick it's going to leave me on ADSR, but be on my kick now. So that's kind of helpful. But yeah, the touchscreen honestly isn't that bad on the black box. Okay, last but not least, I kind of want to tie in two things for this last part, just so I can put it at a nice, beautiful number of 5. But the storage, the black box uses an SD card, micro SD card. So you're limited theoretically by however big your SD card is. On the Digitakt, you have, I think it's a 1 gig plus drive plus your RAM for your samples, which is only 128 sounds. Yeah, 128. So 127 plus zero, which is off. Huh. So you have 127 sounds. They robbed you. So this RAM actually fills up pretty quick, especially if you start using one shots and loops and things like that, which is again why I use this more as a drum machine. Here, you can just pull them straight off of the SD card. It plays them off of the SD card. This does mean if you go to load a new preset, like let's just load this track here, it takes a little bit when you're playing. Like if this was playing and I say load preset, let's do 1010 day load. It takes a second. You'll start hearing old sounds. It can sound kind of cool because it's playing them in tempo and it kind of freaks it all out. But if you're trying to use this live, a lot of times I'll just kind of slowly stop whatever's happening, or I guess I'll go into sequence, stop whatever's happening, then, you know, load a new sound, but leave the tempo playing so it's still locked into time. And see, this one is, maybe there's literally nothing on there. Let me load another one. We'll just do load live 3. So boom, those now load, and now these are loops, and then they're going to launch in time. Boom, they're playing their really long loops. That's why they look so tiny. But if I go and I look at this bad boy, you can see right there, it's just playing this long little loop I have with the Kajimi. So with that, putting samples on both of these is pretty easy. This is a bit, I want to call it more old school, because you just use your Mac Finder window or the Windows File Explorer, I think is the name for it. So if you're used to that, this basically just shows up as an SD card, drag and drop all your things on there. I prefer to put the SD card in an SD card reader, speeds things up a little bit. And the Elektron uses transfer. Now transfer is really good. Elektron knows what they are doing when it comes to these little apps and things. So the transfer allows you to copy, paste, look at your folders, rename stuff. Be careful because you can jack up a lot of your songs, renaming things or moving folders around too much. But the same can be said about the black box. But where I can easily give the Digitakt like 100 points out of 10 is with Overbridge. And I cannot overstate how good Overbridge is. It is absolutely game-changing. I know that word sucks, but it really is. It's such a milestone. Like, we're going to look back in music history and, like, people talk about when they started bringing the first digital audio workstation to NAMM, the National Association of Music Merchants show. And they mentioned how it was like the craziest show ever. I know that kind of wasn't necessarily the same for this. And things have had audio over USB for a really long time, even including like the Novation Ultranova has it. What was another synth that kind of had that type of capability? Anyway, I think Elektron has done it differently because, like, for example, the TR-8S has audio over USB. You can even do audio over USB for some of their boutique synths. Maybe Korg has it in a couple things, but they all work as an aggregate towards your audio interface already. What does that mean? Basically, in my studio, I have the Claret 8 Pre. If I wanted to use the TR-8S in my studio with audio over USB, I have to forego that and say, turn off the Focusrite interface and only listen to the TR-8S while I track some things in. Okay, I'm done. Sweet. Let's switch back to the Focusrite. And now I can't hear the TR-8S live unless I plug in the audio cables. It gets confusing quick, and you can use things like Soundflower, which is an aggregate that kind of manages multiple sound devices at once. I haven't had good experiences with it. I spend more time, you know, trying to figure out what's going on and what's wrong as opposed to making music. But the way Elektron has done it with Overbridge is it's a plugin that lives inside the DAW alongside your audio interface, no problem. And not only that, over the USB, you're sending audio of the left and right output, as well as the 8 independent tracks, 10 audio tracks, and it handles latency. It's dead on timing. You have individual tracks. They're all locked into time. It's absolutely amazing. And the Blackbox has nothing like that at all. It does, though, if you look at the I/O, have a bunch of individual outputs, but that again leaves you a ton of audio cables that you got to deal with. Okay, so let's kind of wrap this up and boil this down. If you are brand spanking new and all you have is a laptop, or not even that, the one thing I usually suggest would be the Digitakt. Again, only because of that Overbridge thing, because it, to me, leaves it as a very, very solid piece of gear that you can grow with. You can start off making whole tracks on here. Then you get a new synth. You have the MIDI tracks. You can use these 8 tracks down here to do MIDI sequencing. So say you get another piece of gear expanding on just those 8 tracks. You start doing stuff with the synthesizer. Then you get a laptop. You got USB. You don't have to worry about any of that stuff. Whereas the Blackbox, you can plug it in with USB and it'll turn on. But that's about it. Then you need to worry about getting audio cables. And with audio cables, then you need to worry about getting an audio interface. With audio interface, you need to learn how that works and deal with that. Then deal with latency. This, again, over USB handles it all. If you have a ton of stuff already and you just kind of want an inspirational thing, or you're itching to buy something new, I would suggest redo your studio. Move things around and get inspired by that first before buying stuff. You don't need more things. But if you are still interested in buying one, and you're doing stuff primarily in the studio, I would probably still go with the Digitakt, because it's just the way it inspires me to do things. But if you have a lot of things and you like to perform live and do more looping stuff or play loops and stuff to kind of help emphasize what you're doing already, I would go with the Blackbox. The Blackbox I use live almost, I'd say 80%, if not a little higher than that, of the time when I play live. But the same could be said about the Digitakt. But where that kind of falls apart is that I don't use the Blackbox in the studio to make music, but I do use the Digitakt in the studio to make music, because then it transforms for me and goes from live drum machine to in the studio drum machine and weird sample manipulator, where the Blackbox is just my live looper and stem playback machine. So I hesitate recommending the Blackbox to most people, mainly because of its interface, I think, because it can be a bit confusing, because I've been making music for a really long time, and there are some things in here that really confused me and still do. Song mode, no idea what's going on with it, but everything else is pretty straightforward. I don't know. I feel like more often than not, you might be let down by the Blackbox than you would be the Digitakt. And that is such a random statement to say, because this all, again, comes all the way back to the beginning, which is qualifying what you want this purchase for and what you need it for. So really think that through and really try and think that through. And when you have an answer for that, try doing it with something you already have, because something might have some creative limitations that kind of spark your interest in letting you do something new. And I know me saying this is confusing and people look at this and say, but what about the Elektron workflow? It's not that bad. Like, the Elektron workflow is super simple. You go to track one. How's the trigger working? What source is it playing? Filter, amp, LFO. Beyond basic. Multiply that by 8. Cool. You're good to go. What more do you want? Oh, you want more? You have tons more. There's tons more to explore. But if you just leave it kind of surface level, you're good to go. It's not that bad. So, and this one, same thing. I mean, you can use it very basically, but some things, even then, it's still kind of like, wait, why is this button here? And why do I need to go here to do that? So, yeah, take that with a grain of salt, I guess. I love these both. I use them both all the time. When I'm playing live, I use them both. When I'm in the studio, I use this one more. But even right now, this one's been collecting dust, and I've just been using drum rack or the analog rhythm. And anyway, that's it for me. I'll leave it at that. Hope you're doing okay. Hope you're having a good year. It's going to be a great one this time. And it's good to see you. Love you. Appreciate you so much. Thanks for hanging out. And until the next one, you already know the drill. Share the love. Share the knowledge. Knowledge is power. Peace. Don't know what to do since there's no audio in this one. Guess I'll
walk away.
Yeah, it's kind of nice over here. I'm going to go stand over there. Maybe I'll stand over here.